Dobro jutro, Warsting. So now I switched to English. My presentation will be about industrial Internet of Things. I think it's a keyword for smart production. In our opinion, it's all about communication, and I will go through this presentation. There are some basics at the start, and then I want to introduce you how Fronius thinks we can handle this topic. So this is the way. Some small parts about the Industry 4.0, the solution challenges for the customer, best practice. We have a solution that's called WellCube Premium. It's an on-premise solution. And then the continue. From Industrial 4.0, there is a big dream, what it is. Then there is a reality, and then the idea behind it. Industrial 4.0. I don't know, I don't like. It's one of the reactions. The managers like it, they're from the production line. They think it's maybe not so good. That costs jobs and so on, so you have to handle with this. I heard before, that's nothing about software, so it's about the mindset you have to do. I bought Industry 4.0, I have a Industry 4.0 manager, so everything is done, everything is okay. I want to increase the efficiency for my production, optimize processes, that's one step. I develop new business models, that's are the who delivers the parts, like Fronius. This is our goals. Our company already lives Industry 4.0. What's more, so we have a production, we have SPS, we have automation, so what are you talking about? And this is the overall picture for Industry 4.0. It goes from the automation to the connectivity, to cloud computing, from the edge. It's an IoT thing. There is the big data, so big data, big challenges. Then the system integration. So the systems may be older than 1 year. The system, the production system from our customers may be from the 2000 or 90s. So there's also a big challenge. There are the four phases from the Industrial Revolution. I think the first one was the mechanical. The second one was to industrialize this. So Ford, we know about him. The third was the how the electronics stuff and the IT comes to the production, and the fourth is now what we are all talking about the cybernetic systems and how to handle this and how to get the right mindset to handle this option. Yeah, behind. We all know it. The Internet of Things comes to the kitchen, it comes to maybe places where we want that the Industry 4.0 doesn't come. The cooler knows what you are eating, how many you eat, and it's easy for handling because then you know the milk is empty, I need some milk. And the coffee machines knows the right intensity of your coffee and it's perfect every day. And it's optimized every day. The Industrial Internet of Things is like the same way, so we want that this is all connected from the underground, from these sensors, from the reporter, barcode reader and so on, from the visualization up to the standard switches and up to the cloud. That's one big challenge also for the customer because cloud is bad. I want the data's not there. That's also a big mind shift because the units here can be more efficient and have a higher rate for the analysis the data's. There are all some slides like this, good looking pictures where the manager says, "Oh, that looks great. I want this because I get an email when something happened." That there is more than this in the logic, so you have to prepare more things like that is, I think this is a better picture to explain Industry 4.0 and what's the main reasons why it is so difficult to understand in an organization? Because nowadays in the industry, there are people which are responsible for this line. So they are in the production, they are responsible for this, they make some standardization from the field buses, from the sensors, this is their daily work. So this is their business and they say, we need this, this is important. On the other hand, there is another unit which is for the SPS programming, maybe some visualization of the machines and so stuff. So they have their own level, and they are responsible for this, and they feel it's comfortable. Then there are the process owners and so stuff. They have also their own line, which they are responsible, and then the production, and then overall the CEO, who is for every production in every land, in every country. So it's a clear hierarchy, and it's everything, it's fine, because everybody has his own responsibility. With the Industry 4.0, there is a big shift in this mindset, because with this now all devices are connected. There are not, you cannot isolate the responsible for one person in one line. It's up and down in each direction to each time. So that's a big change in the way of thinking, because these data will be all aggregated and are all available on each level. So when you optimize the sensor, the data from the overall plants, from each plant of the world, is available to optimize the sensor or optimize this process step. That's a big change, and so the lines, the persons maybe think that they are losing power, that they are losing power, but they don't see the opportunity that they will get more information, better processes, easier life time, and so we think it's about smart production is a better word for it than Industry 4.0, because it's more like what it is. And the goal of it is, in my opinion, that there is a smooth operations. That means everything works. We only have to be there if something happened. Otherwise, it's working and the life is better for everyone in this process. So the products of the future and their production. People who understand this, they are connecting these levels. They don't connect in the production as they also connect the device with the in the lifetime. So after they sell it, they also connect it to the devices, and they are connected to the devices at the end of their life, like this one. So with each car they are selling, with each mile they are driving, the company is learning how the product works, how the user use it, and so they get starters, they can make algorithm. And I think a good example is, I think Google was driving with his car, I don't know, 100,000 miles in a year. They put the car on the road, send the data, and I think they have in 1 year 1 billion mile. So they have 10 times more data than Google, which their cars which driving were driving through America. So that's the big thing. Collecting and evaluate data. The idea is that there is a big data lake, like a lot of words, keywords, which in the management meetings, like bullshit bingo. So there is big data, data lake, analytics, and so on stuff. And so you have to break it down that you really know what you are looking for, because everybody is searching for the needle in the haystack. So they say, oh, there we are. Now we have, I don't know, 3 terabytes of data, and there is this one needle we are looking for, but they are looking for this needle like, yeah, there's a data, no, and this isn't it, and this database, no, we didn't find it. So the main thing or the main topic you as developers have to do is to find the right method. You can go with a magnet, there are so many machine learning algorithms, how you can use it and how you can find it, or you need, you do it with fire. So you can burn it down and find the needle, or you go with a magnet through the data. You have to decide which method is the right one to find the needle. Quality of data. Data are the new oil. Yeah, it's an, for me an old sentence. I don't know how you feel it. Everybody is talking that the data are the new oil, and that's the biggest thing. And you have to don't give it away. Everybody's giving away with the smartphone, but in the industry, it, you don't do it. Everybody private sees, oh yeah, now Google says me how when I have to drive home because there's a traffic jam and otherwise I come late to this meeting and so on stuff. And I think the challenge here is that you have to do which oil you are talking about. So is this data, you don't even need it, so there you have to select it, which data you can give to the customer, with data you can collect, or you have to discuss with the customers which data you get, and then you can make a guess of it. So this is a big thing, because this is not like the company can decide on its own, and not the developer or the customer can decide it on their own. You have to get it together, and that's, you have to talk to about it, what you are looking for, and which data you need for the gas. So, as I told you, you have to talk with the customers, you have to make the invisible visible. So, before you start to talk about machine learning or industrial Internet of Things, you have to clarify what he's looking for and what is the main problem of the customer. So, you have to find the right data. That means there is a black hole. You can see, I see what you don't see, and everybody is looking about the stars around it, but nobody is seeing the black. So the black is the fascinating thing and not the stars around it. What does the internet knows about you? As I mentioned before, Google know what you are searching for. The next, Facebook knows what you like, and Amazon knows what you will buy, or what are you buying. And these are the main USPs from these companies, that they know this. And I think you have to clarify with the customer what's the USP, what he wants to find in the data. And that's the step for Industry 4.0, because I think the most companies use this word for smart production, but they don't think about it, what they are looking for. Yeah. This is also the goal, the from Amazon. So they're looking for predictive shipping and predictive maintenance. So they give the packages and they know where they are used. And so they have the stores over the world, and so they can deliver packages in 1 hour or maybe 24 hours. So, data protection and data security. How safe are IoT and IIoT? Yeah, it's, there are so many things about OPC UE, MQTT, and so on, and before you have to do the security risk and the IoT, because yeah, you must get connected, but otherwise you will be open for an attack from outside. So if you don't take security risks really high, then you will be infected. And also with this, there comes not like you have to false material for the, I don't know, for the car. There is also like the servers can be attacked, like DDoS or something like that. So you have to be carefully that there are the right, that you are prepared for this. Yeah, I think that. So the man in the age of Industry 4.0, machine learning employers training. So, This picture shows before there was a man who was building everything. There was no time because he knows how to repair a car. Now with this Industry 4.0, there is in the welding technology, the people are not so good educated, so there is no time for education. Before there was time to educate them and so on and so on. And now they're coming from the school, or maybe not from the school, they're coming from the streets, and they say, okay, you are now a welder and you should weld. So it is getting harder for the companies to find good prepared people for this education. So they go to the step also as smart production or Industry 4.0. That's why also people say that they are losing their jobs, because machines give them this what they have to do. So they give them four which steps they have in the production. This why there is a plane, because the behind this picture is a story, because the CEO from Boeing said maybe we go a step too far because we think people are always the right decision makers. The people need more information to do right decisions. So it is not the goal for us to like this, that the computer makes everything. For us is the goal that there are also like this pilots who makes on the starters right decisions in the right way. It's also like this where the speed comes up. So it should not be the computer. So I go further. Maybe I should go to this picture because that shows where Fronius is involved. This is a production line, a normal production line where there are hundreds of machines, hundreds of datas. And so with this data collection and the smart production, we want that the customer makes right decisions because there are small parts, and when you get it together, as I mentioned before, then you can make good decisions. So now the next topic, artificial intelligence. What is artificial intelligence and what about us? So there are some apps like Tinder. They're looking for which you like, you don't like, you want to tap, and they are learning which people you will be able to like because of the topics they have on their screen. Then there is a this was so far developed that there was a KI, and the people like the KI because they didn't know that there is no people behind that. That's an artificial intelligence. They are talking with this on this channel. So there is the artificial intelligence gets more a human than you think. As a summary, Industry 4.0 is not a product, but an attitude. The intelligent network of all players within the value chain, so they must be connected. The digitalization of all relevant information, so if you have it not digital, it's not an information. Evaluation of data in real time, the connection must be good, that this is possible. Make decisions based on profound predictions, more social than technical challenges. As I mentioned, the people are more afraid of it than they like it in the first step. And the AI is already among us. So that means, yeah, every internet site, which is a bigger one, has an AI behind it so that they make the right way. And we still have a long way. That means, yeah, there are some highlights like Amazon or Facebook or Google or Apple, but it's not in the normal industry. So the normal industry is like machine learning or data analysis, but it's not in the eye level. So our industry 4.0 way. The first step we make with this machine, it's called TPSI. It's a Linux-based system, which is decentralized, communicates decentralized. So that's the big possibility where we start this development in 2007. So in 2007, nobody was talking about Industry 4.0 smart production, but we have seen it in the industry that the connector, the connection needs more, or it will be a bigger part in the industry, and so we start this development. We have modularized this, so there is one Linux system, and we use it in I think 40 types of machines, from small manual welders for small industry or for small companies, up to the big automobilists. It's individual, adaptable, so that means we can put some stuff on it afterwards, like via internet services, so we can upgrade the machines and to use the internet and the linked machines. It's high intelligent and extensive because with the connection, the machine can learn from other machines in the network. It's variety of welding processes. And so we have these three main parts we want. That was the goal when we started production or the project, is what's individuality, improvement, and interaction. And for this one, there is also when we cooperate with Serengeti, there is a robot interface. And the robot interface, there is RobPro called, and there is a connection to the robot and other infrastructure. And this is for each customer, it's separate. So you have to configure it, and that in reality is with this interface designer, the customer can change the channels, can change the signal outputs, and make some own logic for their own. More solutions. This is, I mentioned, the WellCube. I think it's a good logo, this quarters. Then the user management system. So you have to protect the data, so, and also to protect the system. So it is very important that the customers, not every customer, or not every person from the customer can accept this. And the data interfaces for the connectivity, so that the sensors can report to the higher level systems. Challenging of data collection analysis. The record and setting parameters, there are 100 parameters and how they are set work. The recording actual values and the rate. The monitoring compliance with the target specifications. The reaction output signals in case of deviation, and also the recording deviation. So there are a lot of data which had to be collected. But I think, 10 years ago, we have also recorded this. So we have tons of data, gigabytes. I think the last version of it was called Fronius Explorer before we developed the WellCube Premium. And at the end of the lifetime, the software needs 1 hour to start up because it was not for this amounts of data built. So now we have go a step back and have said, okay, what we need to analyze these data, because now we have current voltage and welding time over tons of seconds, but we don't know what was weld. So we have go back. We have to go a step back and make about traceability. So we have to deeper understand how the customer works, that we have good data for analysis and give them a benefit from their own data. And then we make this picture where we connected the use cases from the customer, from dashboards for each level, for an overview from the machines and the health of the machines, and also APIs, failures, and so on and so on, so that the customer has overall reports. There is also on the Fronius website, there is also a demo bell cube where you can log in and play with this software. So, where can the Fronius software help you? It can help in the efficient authorization of the welding system. So with the Velcube Premium, also the server-based software, the machine software, also the app and so on, this is all connected. So with one authorization, you can use all devices, from all software parts from the Fronius. You have the traceability, you can with the recording trick have you the analysis data, the traceability data, and so on. So what we this now are softwares, and they are all in one, in the hand of Fronius or in the hand of the customers when it's on premise. So we have to go a step further for the connection. So this is Velcube Connect. So this Velcube is a name for all the data we're looking for, and this is the overall system picture. So there are some names, like there are the machines which are collected from the Velcube and the TPSI, and they have gateways like OPC UA, MQTT for the higher level, which over the Velcube Connect, it's like an edge, as you maybe know, and this goes to the mess and ERP system from the customers. So now with this Velcube Connect, there are connected from the displays, from the simple recording, from the documentation and analysis through the maintenance, which we can now can use this for predictive maintenance and also analysis for the whole stuff. And with this OPC UA, you get only the parameters out of it. With the other system, you get more. That's now a comparison between the OPC UA and MQTT and the REST API from the Velcube Premium that should show what's the benefit of it. So on the other hand, on the one hand, you only get the live data. This is like for companies or solution partners like Serengeti, the chance to build up their own software solutions or help Fronius to get in customization for the customer. And there is the REST API from the Velcube Premium with these prepared data and the historical data, so they get the whole part report out of it. So for the customer, it's more on his hands. So bigger companies do it on their own, like BMW, Daimler, Audi, Volkswagen, and so on. They like more OPC UA, but for the others who like it easier, they're using the REST API from the Velcube. So this is the machine, there's an overview. For this, I think there's also one challenge in the Industry 4.0, which is not so big, because the data, everybody, every sensor is collecting data and makes data, like in normal IoT. But there you need, to verify these data, you need an NTP server, so that these data are synchronized and they are always on the same time when they are able, or when they were produced. And then you go to the part ID from the SPS or WebConnect. This is from the customer system. Also, a user is logged in, or the robot. With the central user management, it's detected. Also, the user comes from the HR software, so every company has an HR solution inside, and so there is an API, a REST API for the central user management. And with these data, go back from the machine with or Velcube with MQTT and OPC UA to to the customer server, or it goes to the WebCube Premium. And we are now working on WebCube Air. That means that we have a cloud solution for this if the customer has no IT infrastructure. And I think this picture shows good how Fronius is working in the smart production, or how we want to solve the smart production. So with this APIs and inputs and outputs, we give the customer the whole opportunity to do to build up their own smart factory system. Implementation traceability with Fronius and TPSI WebCube. As I mentioned before, we were not interested in parts, and with this smart production, we have to take a look at how the customer works, and now we are preparing parts. So this is the sheet. It's from our own. It's from the cooling unit. So that's the reason why I can show you that. Where the part is identified, where this blue one are the welding seams, and also the parameters of these welding seams, like here, which job is welding this parameter seam. So we have the whole connection from the part. With this, there's also no the item number and the part number, so you can afterwards you can identify which datas this were. The picture and the datas, as I mentioned. So sending components information. So that means you have to identify where which part it is. The customer do it normally via NFC or QR code or what else? And this comes from the PLC to the machine, and there will be connected. And so that's also a good picture that all workers must work together, because in bigger companies, these parts are in several departments. So the departments have to work together. As I mentioned, that's a big shift to the old process. From the TPSI internal memory, so the data will be collected. The TPSI is connected to the NTP server, where the clock time comes and will be sent to the WebCube Premium. Documentation and reporting. So this is then when the welding was done from this part. Every single weld is green. There is also a Q-master, we call it Q-master. It's a plus minus regulation. And then the seams are all developed, and you can click on this and you see the report from the data from this one welding seam. So that was not be able before. As I mentioned, there is the part number, the identifier, also the welding time, and so on. So there is an API where the customer can put the data out of our system, because it's important that the customers get the data, otherwise they don't trust the system. This is one statistics, we call it statistic. Other companies would say this is the first machine learning algorithm. For me, it's statistics. So the system knows which day, which part will be welded, and they can analyze on the part or on which parts, like here. On this part, this seam makes the most problems, and the customer know, okay, when I want to optimize this, when I want to optimize this article number, this job I have to, or this welding seam I have to optimize. And the other way, it was the customer, the only experienced welders know where they have to optimize, and they have to go to the ground floor and ask the people. With also this email reporting and stuff. Yeah. This is server-based, so you can use it in the browser, you can make it on the smartphone. It's one tool for every product. That's also important, because our customers have welding machines, and the welding machines live 20 years. So they have welding machines from 1998, and they also want these welding machines also in the data storage, and that's the reason why we have also connections to these old welding machines. where to go on. So the future, it's cloud-based. As I mentioned, the future will be this predictive maintenance, the assistant system because of the education from the people who are working on the floors. I hope it was a little bit interesting for you guys and girls. And yeah, we are looking for people who help us to make this vision real life. Thank you.
Thank you.